In this video, we will see the different signals for 8086 microprocessor. So this indicates the pin diagram for 8086 microprocessor. It is a 40-pin IC in which the pins have different values under different configurations. So for example, these particular pins, they have different functionality in the minimum mode and in the maximum mode. So in the minimum mode is nothing but the 8086 is used as a single processor in a system, whereas in the max mode it is used in a multiprocessor environment. So generally speaking, the signals, they can be active high or active low. So active high signals, it indicates the signal performs its function when its value is 1. For example, reset. So reset operation will happen when this signal is high. In the case of active low signal, so the functionality is performed when that signal value is 0. So for example, read bar. So it is generated by a bar over the signal. It indicates the read functionality will happen whenever the signal goes low. Then the type of signals, they can be categorized into 3. The first one being input signal, so which access an input to the microprocessor. The next one is the output signal. So the signal is the output from the microprocessor to the other devices. The third one is a tri-state or tri-stated. So it is a high impedance state. So we'll see what is tri-state logic. So consider example of a tri-state buffer. So assume we have an input, we have an output, and we have an enable line. So when the enable line is present, whatever is given in the input, it will go to the output. When the input is low, output will be low. When the input is high, the output will be high. Consider the case when this enable is removed, in which case, even though the input output pins are present, but they are logically disconnected, electrically disconnected between the input and the output. So this condition is called as a tri-state condition. So now we will look into the 8086 signals. So the table gives the pin number, the symbol in the pin diagram, then the type, whether it is a input or output or input and output, and it is a three-state logic. Then the description. So pin numbers 1 and 20 represent the ground. Pins 2 to 16, okay, they are AD0 to AD14. So AD refers to the address and data bus. So bus, it indicates a group of signals doing the same functionality. Since all of these pins do the similar functionality, they are grouped to call it as bus. So this address and data bus are multiplexed. So these pins act as a address during the first part of any cycle, and they act as input or output data. So they act as data during the later part of the cycle. Pin number 17, it is a NMI, non-maskable interrupt. Pin number 18 is interrupt. It is a maskable interrupt. It is a level trigger input. Then pin number 19 is a clock signal, which accesses an input. So clock, it is a 33% duty cycle clock. So it can have 5 MHz, 8 MHz or 10 MHz depending upon the model of the 8086 microprocessor. Pin number 21 is the reset, which is an input. It terminates activity. So as soon as the reset is applied, so it starts operation again from the first. So the processing begins from FFFF0 address whenever this reset is dropped. So it should always be, it should be 1 for at least 4 clock cycles for the reset operation to complete. The next one is pin number 22, which is a ready signal. It is an input signal. It is used as an acknowledgement from the memory or I/O device, indicating the processor can perform any other operation. Pin number 23, it is a test active low signal. Access an input. So this test signal is used along with the wait instruction. So wait instruction makes the CPU idle and as long as this test pin is made low. So if this test pin is low and if the wait instruction is used, so the CPU will be put up into idle state. Okay. Then pin number 24 to 31, they have different definitions based on whether it is a minimum mode or maximum mode, which we'll see later. Pin number 32 is a active low read signal. It will act as an output or it will become tri-state. So it indicates some memory or IO read operation is to be performed. Then 33 is the mode pin or minimum or maximum mode. So as it indicate, MX is active low. So if it is going to be minimum mode, this pin should be stepped to 5 volts. If it is going to be maximum mode or multiprocessor configuration, this pin should be connected to ground. So next pin is pin number 34, which is bus high enable or S7. So this is a output signal. So if it is zero during the first part of bus cycle, then at least one byte transfer on AD15 to AD8. So AD8 to, so the data lines, it is a 16 bit processor, so we have D0 to D15. So D0 to D7 represents the lower byte and D8 to D15 represents the higher byte. So whenever there is any operation on the higher byte, then this bus high enable will be active, meaning it will be zero, indicating the transfer on the higher order bus. A16 to A19 are the upper 4 bits of address during the first part of the cycle, or it indicates the status during the later part. So here, based upon S3 and S4, you can represent what is the segment address that is being used. So for example, if it is 00, it indicates the extra segment access. If it is 01, stack segment. If it is 10, it could be code segment or no access. If it is going to be 11, it is going to be data segment. Status S5 indicates the status of the interrupt flag. S6 is always low. So AD15 is pin number 39. It is similar to any other address data line as we have seen in the earlier pins. And pin number 40 is the VCC, which is a supply voltage of 5 volts. So going by the remaining signals, so first we'll see the minimum mode signals for pin number 24 to 31. So pin number 24 indicates it is an output interrupt acknowledge. Whenever any interrupt occurs to the microprocessor, it acknowledges using this signal. The next signal, pin number 25, is an important signal, address latch enable. So it is nothing but a pulse at the beginning of bus cycle. So whenever ALE is high, it indicates the AD0 to AD15 we have seen, in that pin accesses the address line as long as ALE is high. So when ALE is low, then those pins represent the data. Next one is pin number 26, which is a DEN, data enable. So it indicates whether the CPU is ready to send or receive the data. Okay. Next one, pin number 27 is DT/R. So it indicates to the transceivers whether to transmit or receive. If it is going to be data from the processor, it is going to be a transmit. If it is a data to be read by the microprocessor, and then it will be a receive. Then pin number 28 is used to differentiate between a memory or a IO transfer. If this pin is going to be low, it indicates a IO transfer. If this pin is high, it indicates a memory transfer. Pin number 29 is an active low output signal write. So whenever write operation is going to be performed, then this signal needs to go low by the microprocessor. Pin number 30 is a hold acknowledge. So whenever any other bus master requests the address and data bus for any other operations, so this hold acknowledge will be 1 and the microprocessor will relinquish its control over the bus as long as this HLDA is 1. Hold, it is the request by the other bus masters to take hold of the bus. So first the hold will be, this pin will be made high by the bus masters. First a request will come from the other bus masters, after which the microprocessor will acknowledge by using this pin HLDA. So these are the signals with respect to minimum mode, which is a single processor configuration system. Next we'll see the maximum mode signals. So these are the signals that would be used in the case of multiprocessor system, wherein more than one processor will be present in the system. Pin number 24 and 25 represents the status of the instruction queue. And pin number 26, 27 and 28, these three pins represents the type of bus transfer. So depending upon these signals, they indicate whether it is an interrupt acknowledgement or reading an IO port or writing into an IO port or a halt, instruction fetch, reading from the memory or writing to the memory, or it is an inactive or passive cycle. The next pin number 29 is the lock. So we'll get back to this later. Next is the pin number 30, which is a request grant. So in a multiprocessor environment, if bus needs to be used by a certain processor, it will request for bus using the request, and grant will be given through grant. So similarly, request grant 0, but this will have a higher priority. So whenever this pin number 29, when this lock is present, it indicates even though there is a bus request, the grant will not be given. So this lock signal indicates that bus should not be released to the other processor. So these are the signals for 8086.